played since he was little, and you all know about dreams. And this is a guy who's made it, and I'm gonna let him tell his story. But just to kind of give you a little bit of a background of, you know, Kendall here, he played football and baseball. I don't think you didn't do anything in the winter, did you? Strictly football and baseball, I thought. But always was. I don't remember. I think he was a pretty small guy, thin guy coming up. In fact, I don't remember you playing really until your junior year. He came out of junior year, was a slot receiver and backup quarterback. And quick little thing, guys, just to tell you, you know, we talk about not letting your highs get too high and your lows get too low, and keeping your, you know, keeping your cool. I can remember we were playing Briarwood Christian. This was the 2007 year, right, your junior year. Barrett Trotter, if you remember him at Auburn, was the quarterback over there. They had a really good team. And we go out, and our start quarterback was a guy named Casey Cutts, who was having a really good year that year. And so we go out there, and somewhere along the line, Casey got hurt. And you know, we had a slot receiver as our backup quarterback now. He had a good arm. Obviously, he had an arm. He's a major league pitcher now. But he hadn't had a whole lot of reps there that caused a few passes. And I remember that on the headsets, the whole sideline was going, all the coaches were like, oh, no. Because you had to know back then, Casey was really the guy. In fact, I believe he still holds the record, state record for most yards rushed for in a state playoff game. Would that be right? 290 yards as a quarterback rushing against Decatur. So Casey was pretty well thought of, and all of a sudden I see this junior receiver go trotting out on the field, and I'm in the press box, and I told all the coaches, I said, y'all just need to calm down, because the coolest guy out in this whole stadium just ran out on the field. And I was right, I think he was out there, threw a slant. I don't remember all the plays, but I know you completed a pass, and then he was out there three or four plays, all back on the field, back into his receiver role, Casey came back. So that's the kind of guy that I remember. Kendall being just a cool, calm guy. And probably, with all that said, probably he's not like this, but probably one of the most competitive guys I remember. As calm and cool and as nice a guy. I just remember, and a huge Alabama fan. One of the biggest Alabama fans I've ever seen. And I remember we got to go back and forth because, you know, I grew up Georgia and we were playing. And that was the last time I think Georgia beat Alabama. And I remember you sitting in the locker room. And I came in and I just started looking at you, and he just got up and ran. He hated to lose anything. So anyway, guys, I told y'all he's got a great story and a great message he's going to give you. And I just want to thank you again for coming to see us and spend your time with us. And without any more, Kendall Graveman, guys.
I just want to start by saying it's an honor, it's a privilege to stand before you guys today. Scott called me last week, and he was like, hey, you want to come speak at the quarterback club meeting for our guys? And I get asked a lot in the offseason when I'm back home to speak in different places, and sometimes I'll hesitate, sometimes I don't actually go, but I knew as soon as he let me know that I need to come talk to you guys. And it's my honor to stand here in front of you today. I want to say, coaching staff, thank you. I honor you, Coach Smith. I stand in front of you guys. The time, the effort, the energy, the time away from family, the time invested in these guys. Coach Smith, Coach Tate was here when I was here, and the impact that they've made on my life and countless other people. Man, thank you guys. Parents that are in the room, I say thank you for what you've done. I sat in these seats, and there was times where I took for granted a lot of things that parents go to battle for us and take us to and from when we were younger, and the amount of money that goes into it, and I say thank you. And then lastly, get a little choked up, but my parents. Thank you. I wouldn't be here today without them too. My dad pushed me to be who I am. My mom loved and served. I walk in this lunchroom tonight. My mom serving tea. I'm like, it's a godly lady right there. My dad's a godly man, and if I can get half the people you are. Thank you. backup quarterback. He goes into his sophomore season, little high school in California. He says the only reason he was able to play is because the kid in front of him quit. So he got a little playing time. He goes through his sophomore and junior year. In high school, he gets recruited by the University of Michigan. He's going to Ann Arbor. He shows up, seventh on the depth chart. Six guys in front of him. So he gets redshirted. The next year, he doesn't play. His next year, he's the guy. He's proven that he's better than the other quarterbacks. Everybody that's there. Coach had a rule that if it was similar in what the ability was, that the older guy was going to get the nod. So that year, even he didn't play. He goes out his junior year. He three games into the season, a couple games into the season, he finished his last 10 games 10-0. He wins all 10 games at Michigan that year. So fast forward to senior year, you think he's a guy. But Michigan at the time had been recruiting the highly just sought out quarterback in the nation. The best high school quarterback in the nation came to Michigan. So they start splitting time when he's a senior. This guy just won 10 games the year before. He's splitting time with a guy that's a young guy now. Three games into the season, he proves again that he's supposed to be the guy. They end up winning a lot of games at the end of the year. They go to the Orange Bowl and they beat Alabama, actually, in the Orange Bowl that year in overtime, 35-34. You think, man, NFL scouts should be calling, right? The NFL scouting report was, he's too slow, skinny, he can't elude the rush, he lacks the ability to throw the ball downfield, he can't throw a tight spiral. The list went on and on and on. One team called, the New England Patriots. This guy's in his 20th season. Right now, he's won, been a 14-time Pro Bowler. He's won numerous Super Bowls. The list goes on. The accolades are so long, I don't have enough time to say all of them. The second story I want to tell you is a guy that grew up north of Tulsa, Oklahoma. At 8 years old, he's living in a household. His parents get a divorce. His dad gets custody of the kids. It's him. He got four siblings. His dad has no way of making ends meet. They're living in the car. They're in and out of the car. His dad says he used to go park under the street light so that they felt a little bit safer at night. They would do the homework in their car. He would wash their clothes while they were sleeping right outside the car by hand. This kid in third grade wanted to play football. He started playing football. Wanted to be a running back. So he starts running, gets into high school, running back. He goes to McLean High School. And at the time, for 15 years previous to him getting there, there hasn't been a Power 5 FBS football recruit come from his school. So guess who's not showing up? College coaches aren't showing up. If you're not producing recruits, they're not coming. He goes his senior year. He rushes for 2,700 yards, 31 touchdowns, and averages 15.5 yards a carry. Guess how many offers he had? At the time, nobody was calling. A guy encouraged him to start a Twitter account, of all things, and post his story on Twitter, post his running on Twitter. And he got a couple of calls, one of them being over at the University of Alabama. Nick Saban called him, offered him a scholarship. He goes on, plays at Alabama, gets drafted in the first round by the Raiders. Anybody know who the first guy is? Brady. Anybody know who the second guy is?
Jacobs.
What do they got in common? They got a couple things in common, right? They play football. They're now in the NFL. But I like to take it a different route. I think one thing they have in common is they overcame adversity the correct way. They both went through adversity. They look different. The adversities look different in both of their lives. One was really talented, but he had a rough home life. One was not talented, might have had a better home life, had things going for him, but they both made it work. Tonight I want to tell you why adversity is important. Adversity is the most important thing that can happen in your life. It can be the most positive thing if handled the correct way that will ever happen. It's no secret. You guys are 1-7 right now. My senior year, I went 3-7 as a starting quarterback on the team. 3-7. You think I felt good going into a couple of last games of the season? No chance. But I learned a few things. I think adversity first creates toughness. Creates toughness. I tell you, I went 3-7 my first year. I'm in my last year here. I go to Mississippi State to play baseball. I'm like, man, this is the top of the world. I'm in the best conference in America. We won 6 games and lost 24 in the SEC. I'm going back-to-back seasons, losing. Fast forward, in I had Tommy John surgery in 2018. There's a couple guys injured in here. That's another thing I've had. 18-month rehab process. I missed a game. During that, 3 months after Tommy John surgery, my neck starts bothering me. Thought I slept on it wrong. I'm like, ah, it's going away. I got a crick in my neck. 5 months later, my neck still bothering me. I go to the doctor. I find out I have a benign bone tumor in my cervical spine that they say they can't remove. I remember a time when I was at Mississippi State, my sophomore year. I was talking to Dad about it the other day. I started as a freshman. My sophomore year, I got demoted. I got left off the travel roster. Felt terrible. But I tell you, through all these things that I've experienced in my life, the adversities, it's created toughness inside of me. I believe it can do the same in your life through this season. The second thing I think it creates is leaders. When things aren't going well, everybody's looking around. How's he going to respond? How's he going to respond? Who's going to step up and be the guy? It's a very, very unique opportunity that each one of you have. Seniors, lead the right way on the way out. I challenge you. Freshman and sophomore, these coaches, Steph, they're looking at you, how you're going to respond in a tough season. Because moving forward, guess what? They're going to know who they can trust and who they can't. Right? I think through adversity, leaders are created. I think the last thing that adversity does is it creates winners. And I'm not saying it translates to wins. I'm saying winners. Some of you are going to go and play or not play sports after high school. I see doctors in this room. I see engineers in this room. I see business owners in this room. I want you to be a winner when you're done, when you're doing that. I see coaches and teachers in this room. How can you be a winner? I tell you, that freshman year we had 6-24. It propelled us to what we did in 2013. We were 8 outs away from going to Omaha, which, if you don't know, Omaha is the College World Series, the last 16 teams in the nation to go there for baseball and compete for a national title. We were 8 outs away my sophomore year. Didn't win my junior year, but my senior year we went to Omaha. We were able to compete for a national championship. It was us and UCLA. They ended up beating us. Now, we didn't win everything. We wanted to be the last team standing. We weren't. But it created winners inside of all of us that were on that team. And I know it can do it with you guys. So you're sitting here like, all right, Kendall, great. We're going through adversity. Tell me how. How can I create toughness? How can I create leaders? And how can I be a winner? I think there's 3 things, and I'll finish with this. There's 3 takeaways that I give you. We can control 3 things going through adversity that will make us what we want to be. We can control our perspective. You're losing? Guess what? What is your perspective? Do you show up every day and, I got to go to practice again? I want to tell you I'm proud of each and every one of you here because you stuck through it. You haven't quit. You're still here. That's the first step to controlling your perspective. You got a healthy body. Be thankful that you get to go out and put on the pads every day. I tell you what, I wish I could go back and put on the pads one more day. I love the game. So, if our perspective is correct, I think the second thing that we can do is control our words. Control our language. I'm a man of faith. I believe Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior. There was 2 times where Father God, God the Father, spoke to Jesus while he was living his ministry on earth. One time when he was baptized, the Mount of Transfiguration. You know what he told him both times? I'm proud of you, and I love you. I believe our words carry weight. I've been in a locker room my whole life. I know the banter and the joking that goes on, right? We pick, we laugh, we cut up, we have a good time. But at some time, we got to be able to use our words to change what's coming up. Hey, man, I'm so proud of you on that play. Maybe it's the guy that's in front of you that's competing for the same job. How can we use our words not to demoralize, but also help each other? How can we talk positively about our coaching staff? How can our coaching staff tell our players that they're proud of each other? That's the second thing we can control during adversity. And lastly, I think we can control our actions. You control your perspective, your words, your actions follow. You're in the weight room, how easy is it knowing that you're not going to be in the playoffs? You got 8 reps, you do 6. How easy is it when you're in the game and you're down and it's towards the end of the game to get the personal foul penalty? I mean, I think the biggest thing that we can do is control our actions and control them in the right way. So I'll leave you with this. If you want to be tough leaders that win, you have to control your perspective, your words, and your actions.